Do you have the Force? Okay, so you know in Star Wars, right? There's the Force, and you can move objects with your mind. Pretty epic. Well, it turns out that when they use the Force to move things, they're actually applying a force as well. And so Newton would recognize that as the Force. The Force in physics is just a pushing or pulling that might generate motion. We push on things, we pull on things, and it'll move them. Unfortunately, I usually have to use my hands. I can't just use my mind, but it remains a force nonetheless. So, let's learn all about forces. Let's review our lesson objectives. We'll start by introducing and using the definition of force, so that you know what a force is. Then we'll explain the vector nature of force, and just remember that a vector is something with direction and magnitude. And because it has magnitude, we'll introduce the unit for a force. Whenever something has a magnitude or a size, we need to have a unit to measure how big it is. So we'll have a unit for that. The only way to get a skateboard moving is to apply force. Every time the foot presses back on the ground, it drives the skateboarder forward. This is a force, and it results in acceleration. Just how fast do you start moving? Well, it depends on how hard you push. Let's take a look at the definition of force, qualitatively, that is with words, and quantitatively, that is with math. First, let's look at the qualitative definition. It's a push or pull on an object that can cause a change in velocity. Let's look at each part of that. It's a push or a pull on an object. So that means we're pushing or pulling on something to hopefully, in some cases, make it move. And that some cases it can move is highlighted by the word can, because it doesn't always cause a change in velocity. It just sometimes causes a change in velocity. And we'll think about why, both in this lesson and in the next one. And then it causes a change in velocity. So not just motion in general. I can have motion without a force, but if I'm changing the velocity, then I definitely have a force. Now let's look at the quantitative definition of force. Force is equal to mass times acceleration. So we can calculate how big a force is if we know the mass and acceleration. We often abbreviate this as F equals ma. Now let's look at circumstances where we know there's a force. We know there's a force whenever there's acceleration. So when we speed up, we're accelerating and there must be a force. And it's pointing in the direction we're speeding up. When we slow down, there's acceleration and so there must be a force. Here, the force is pushing the car backwards to make it go slower. That wall is applying a force, a pushing force on that car. But also turning involves acceleration. Remember that when we turn, we're changing our velocity. The direction our car is moving is changing. That means there's a force, because there's acceleration. Now, as I mentioned before, force doesn't always come with acceleration. Sometimes we have force without motion. This man is pushing on this rock, but it's not going to move. We know that. And the reason is because there's an equal and opposite force. So sometimes there's multiple forces at play, which can cancel each other out. In this case, it's the friction. That rock is resisting motion. And so though there's a force being applied, there's no actual motion created. We're going to take a much closer look at circumstances with multiple forces in our next few lessons. Now let's highlight two important things about a force. Remember, in all of these cases, we've looked at the fact that force has a direction. Because it's a vector, it always has a direction. And because it's a vector, it has a unit. In this case, the unit is the Newton, named after Sir Isaac Newton, who we said in the introduction to this unit that he was really important in playing a role in developing all of the equations of motion. So this is what we call the SI unit for force, basically just the standard unit we use for force. What is it equal to? Well, we use an N to abbreviate Newton. So one Newton turns out to actually be equal to a bunch of other units here. A kilogram, a meter up top, and a second squared on the bottom. That looks like a big, complicated mess. So if that looks scary, that's totally okay. In fact, it looks a little scary to me. So when we take a look at some problems where we solve for acceleration, we'll really slow down and think about just what this Newton thing is. Let's go ahead and take a look at a problem. In this problem, we're told that a skateboarder with a mass of 40 kilograms presses his foot against the ground and accelerates at a rate of 0.4 meters per second squared. What force was generated by the skater's foot? So we know we're looking for force in this case. So we're looking for F. And we've been given a couple pieces of information. We've been given the mass, and the mass we know is 40 kilograms. And we've also been given the acceleration. And the acceleration is 0.4 meters per second squared. Now we know that force is just equal to mass times acceleration. So let's do that. Now, you'll recall earlier in the lesson, we talked about how the units for force were kind of confusing. Well, now we can start to see how they make sense. When we plug in 40 kilograms times 0.4 meters per second squared, we can see that we get both kilograms and meters per second squared in there. So let's keep working with this to see how these combine eventually into newtons. Well, 40 times 0.4 just turns out to be 16. So we'll combine those two into 16. And then we have left over our units, which is kilograms and meters per second squared. That all combines into a new unit. Rather than just leaving it with this kind of mess of kilograms, meters per second squared, we get rid of all of that. And what we do is we just say, you know what, instead we'll just call it a newton. So we get rid of all that mess and we just put an N. So a newton is a stand-in for kilograms, meters per second squared. Last thing here, our numbers in this problem have one sig fig. The 40, just the 4 is significant. And in the 0.4, just the 0.4 is significant. So we want one sig fig. So we're going to go ahead and round this. And the 6 rounds our 1 up to a 2. And so we'll get 20 newtons. So that's the force exerted by the skater's foot. Let's do one more problem with this F equals ma equation. This one will be just a little bit more challenging. Here we're told that a skateboarder with a mass of 40 kilograms slows down due to friction. So on the skateboard, there's this force of friction slowing it down. And it slows it down from 5 meters per second to 0 meters per second over a 10 second period. And we want to know, what is the force of friction acting on the skateboarder? Well, that's a lot. And maybe you feel like, I have no idea. That's okay. What we're going to start with, and what's always a good idea, is just slow yourself down. Make yourself write down what we know. Don't even worry about how you're going to solve it. Because as you write down what we know, you're going to get a clearer idea in your head of how to solve this problem. So first up, our mass is 40 kilograms. So far, so good. Now, what are these 5 meters per second and 0 meters per second thing? Well, that's actually our velocities, right? Meters per second is the units that tell us we were going 5 meters per second, and now eventually we go zero. So our initial velocity is that bigger number, 5 meters per second, because we started out moving and eventually we stop. That's our final velocity, 0 meters per second. Lastly, we're told how long that change in velocity takes. It's the time of 10 seconds. Okay. So 10 seconds, and technically we have 10.0 seconds, which changes our sig figs. Anyway, we have 10.0 seconds there. Now we want to know what? We want to know the force. So we're looking for force. Of course, if I write out my force equation, I'll see that F equals ma, and I have mass, so that's good, but I don't have acceleration. And so since I don't have acceleration, I can't solve that problem without first getting it. So let's use our equation for acceleration to first solve for that, and then we'll come back to our F equals ma equation. Okay, so our acceleration we know is equal to our delta v over t. Does anybody remember what delta v means? It means change in velocity. So what I can do is I can calculate that change by doing velocity final minus velocity initial over time. So that means I'm going to do my final velocity of 0 minus my initial velocity of 5, all divided by my time of 10.0. Okay, so 0 minus 5.0 divided by 10.0 will give me my acceleration, and that's going to be 0.5 meters per second squared. And it's actually going to be negative. We're slowing down. Remember that acceleration can be speeding up or slowing down, or even turning. So that negative sign there means that we're slowing down over time. Okay, let's go ahead and plug that in to get the force. So now we know force is equal to our mass times acceleration. Our mass is 40 kilograms, and our acceleration is negative 0.5. This is going to give us a negative sign in our force, which means it's a force slowing us down. It's pushing backwards. Whenever we have a sign on our force or acceleration, it's telling us direction. So our force then is going to be equal to 20 newtons. And there's going to be a negative sign there. Now, if I think about my sig figs, we'll notice that my mass, 40.0, has 3 sig figs. My velocity initial, 5.0, just has 2. So we're going to round to 2 sig figs. Now, rounding this to 2 sig figs is a little hard because I have this 0 that I want to make significant. How do I do that? I just add a decimal. When I add a decimal, that's telling people, hey, I actually know that 0. It's 20.0. Okay, so the force of friction in this case is minus 20 newtons. Let's sum up what we've learned. We've introduced and used the definition of force. We talked about how you can identify the presence of a force whenever you have acceleration, and how in some cases, actually, there can be a force present without motion. Usually then there's multiple forces present. Then we explained the vector nature of force, how force always has a direction. And then we introduced the unit for a force, the newton.